Here it has abandoned the traversal mode and become only able to take selfies and aerial photos. The single unit is $2,788. Today we will do an in-depth review. Is it worth the $1,489 more expensive? How does it perform in selfie and aerial photography modes? And what problems are there? As usual, let's unbox it and see what's inside. Mine is the smooth set with screen control. Opening it is a portable bag, a charging hub, 1-3 batteries, a screwdriver, and 3 spare propellers. Manual and quick start guide. These are all the things it has. The drone adopts a foldable design for portability. When unfolding it, first unfold the front arms and then the rear arms. It's just that whether in storage or unfolded state, it's not small at all. And this propeller guard has no aesthetic appeal whatsoever. Some say it looks like a bicycle, some say it looks like a wheelchair. In short, it's a runaway leader in the ugly race. It can be called the aesthetic low point of the drone world, although its appearance slightly improves when flying. But it's still not good looking. The appearance is much worse. It seems that DJI has completely abandoned aesthetics for performance. I really doubt that little fairies who pursue aesthetics will choose it on one side of the fuselage are the power indicator and power button. But I have never used this power button once. When unfolding any of the rear arms, the drone will automatically power on. When storing, folding the 2 rear arms, the drone will automatically power off within 5 seconds. I still like this feature very much, and a mode switch button when switching. The front panel will have corresponding display and voice prompts. The battery is top mounted. The charging hub has 4 battery slots, but there are only 3 batteries. Those with odd should buy one themselves. We'll talk about charging and battery life later. Also remind everyone to remove the gimbal cover. You can see a silicone protective cover on the gimbal. The manual says it is recommended to remove and discard it, but my suggestion is don't throw it away. There's nothing to say about takeoff. It's still clean and neat. Fadeaway has 2 meters, 4 meters, 6 meters, and 10 meters in 2 heights. Level and high-rise rocket has 4 meters, 6 meters, 10 meters, 20 meters. You can also add rotation. Orbit has 2 meters, 4 meters, 6 meters, 10 meters, 20 meters in 2 heights. Level and low, so has the small range. Orbit stuttering problem been solved? It's solved, but not completely solved, but it's still not that smooth. Large range is very smooth if the environment allows. Try to use large range orbit as much as possible. In addition, I also encountered orbit selection 1 not executing in icy and snowy environments. Now the drone has already taken off, and then I set it to 2 meters low in orbit. Orbit now, it shows it's running, but it's not working. Let's try again, still not working. I don't know why. Then we'll adjust it to 4 meters for start, of course. It's not always like this. It's just a probability. I hope it can be optimized for snowy scenes in the future. Spiral and Comet can also be set from 4 meters to 20 meters. When using these 2 functions, try to choose a large range as well, like orbit. Don't expect the smoothness of small ranges. It's the same with all kinds of stuttering, the same 20 meter spiral. Where the hell did you go? There are 2 types of follow me. 1 is normal follow. It can only follow you forward. The distance can be selected as far, medium, and near. The height can be selected as high, medium, and low. The other is mirror follow. It has everything that normal follow has. Not only can it follow you forward, it can also follow you backward. The actual effect of the 2 follows are quite good. I was quite worried, but now it has added LiDAR, although it can only stop. It cannot bypass obstacles for follow-up shooting, but it can indeed avoid many accidents. As for follow, I have another suggestion. Now it can only follow from the front and follow from the back. It cannot follow from the side, even if you put the drone on the side. It will automatically switch to back follow. I hope DJI will add a parallel follow. Multiple perspectives would be more perfect. In addition, gesture recall has also improved a lot. It's more accurate. It can basically be guaranteed to be recognized in one go. It is worth noting that if you put your hand underneath in advance and wait, it will rise a little and then land. Wait for it to stop in front of you, then reach out. This situation will not happen. So from the daytime test, except for adding obstacle avoidance and better safety, that's a crushing existence. As we all know, almost equal to none in situations with more conflicting light, it's barely usable. But when flying into dark areas, it drifts aimlessly, very unsafe, while FLIP greatly enhances nighttime flight and shooting capabilities. Suddenly, it's a 6 meter edge, much more stable throughout. And not only that, when we go to darker environments, Neo just quits and refuses to work. It can't even take off anymore. Why is that? Because the drone is too small. The screen is complete black. It can't recognize people at all, but FLIP can still take off. This gives it a certain nighttime shooting capability. Even in good lighting conditions, doing some following shots isn't impossible. This brings us to talk about its image quality. Although it and the Mini 4 Pro use the same 1.3-inch schmoes from the larger drones, which can shoot up to 4K 60fps video, but we have to look at the price. How much is the Mini 4 Pro? The standard version is 4788. Flip is only 2788 for the single unit. Look at this clarity. Look at this daylight performance. Look at this night scene. Who else is there at this price point? This price performance ratio is unbeatable. Another thing worth praising is the app. When I tested new, I complained about how cumbersome and complex it was to set up camera movement parameters. The experience was terrible, but then DJI updated it. Now, under the mode section, you can directly set the distance and height much more convenient, and the manual mode also added landscape operation. When the selfie mode doesn't capture everything, you can also manually fly it a bit. However, I still recommend everyone buy a remote controller. Even if you don't buy a screen controller, buy a regular controller, even if you don't use it for manual flight with a remote controller. The experience of smart modes will also double. First, the fade away feature has been upgraded from 10 meters in selfie mode to 120 meters rocket, has become 80 meters. Those large scenes that you can't capture fully in selfie mode can be easily handled in aerial mode. And the shooting object is no longer limited to people, buildings, and beautiful scenery can all be shot using smart modes. In addition to those, it can also shoot 1-80-degree wide-angle vertical panoramic photos and also has the dolly zoom feature. Many newbies don't understand dolly zoom. Let me explain it. Simply, after you select a target, the drone automatically performs various camera movements. Then you put it into the app and apply your favorite template, and it will automatically generate a video. The main focus is simple, efficient, and brainless. The smart modes are all quite useful except for time-lapse videos. Flip's wind resistance isn't very good when shooting videos. The three-axis gimbal helps. It's still quite stable, but time-lapse videos are very shaky. The buildings look like they're dancing, although it's Big Brother. The Mist Pro isn't much better, but I can't praise its performance at all. In short, for these features, I feel it's worth buying a remote controller. And with a remote controller, we can also enable aerial mode. Let's take a look at its basic flight capabilities first. How long can it fly? As we all know, it's quite cold here now. Although I chose a warm day to test, it's still around 10 degrees, so the battery life test is for reference only. On the right side of the screen is new in the middle, is Flip. On the left is the Mist Pro making a cameo when testing battery life. We can also look at the stability of hovering. The best hovering is the Mist Pro new is slightly shaky, but it's still okay. While Flip, possibly due to its structure, doesn't have very good altitude hold, it always fluctuates up and down. As for who has the shortest battery life, this question is almost a no-brainer. New hovered until 10% remaining battery for about 13 minutes. Flip is about 22 minutes. The Mist Pro, which joined for fun, lasted the longest at almost 30 minutes when charging using the drone body. To charge, the peak is around 27 watts. But it will drop to 17 watts later. It takes about 79 minutes to fully charge a battery with 20% remaining. It's quite long, but if you use the charging hub, the peak will be around 43 watts. It only takes about 43 minutes to fully charge a battery with 20% remaining. Almost twice as fast in the charging hub's extreme charging function is also quite useful. Also, I didn't quite understand this charging hub. Let me show you my power bank. It can charge the 3S charging hub up to 99 watts now. Our first battery has 55% remaining labeled with a 1. The second battery has 58% remaining logically. It should charge 1 first, then charge it. It does charge 1 first, then charge it. Let's charge for a while and see. Look, it can't charge them simultaneously. Zaitontala kana, the first battery, it's already charged to the fourth bar. The second one still hasn't moved. The wattage is still 44 watts, no change. Do I need some kind of spell? Open sesame, DJI is awesome. How far can it fly on a full charge? Let's first ascend to a height of 30 meters. The signal is not good. Let's continue to ascend. The temperature that day was minus 15 degrees Celsius. The wind was level 1 to 2. I'm doing an extreme test here. Good kids should never imitate this. During the flight, everyone can see the drone often goes down to 29 meters. I need to manually adjust it from time to time. When you fly, you must pay attention. This hook issue, don't be like me if you're not careful. You'll now the location shown here is this tower. That's good. There's still a hedge showing, although the snow is a bit deep. It's here. I can hear it now. I have to go down. I fell. I slid straight down from above. It's here. It's here. It's here. It's not broken. The gimbal seems broken. Let's go out first. Let's go out and see. I slid down from there. Now I can't go up. It's all snow there. It's a big snow slope. I can only go out from this side. I can go out from this side. I can't go up over there. It fell into the snow. Basically, there's no external damage. It's just this jiang yin. The body is not broken. The gimbal was bumped here. It was bumped here. Now the gimbal is not working. The system shows that the gimbal is stuck. It's back to the starting point. It proves that obstacle avoidance is not omnipotent this time. We won't be reckless. Let's fly higher, 50 meters. The temperature that day was minus 12 degrees Celsius, but the wind was level 2 to 3. I hope nothing goes wrong. You always let the ball go. The remote control uses the normal one, that is, Ragan 3, okay, 1,000 meters. It's still stable in the air at 1,500 meters. The signal drops 1 bar. 1,900 meters, only 1 bar of signal left. Let's increase the altitude to 100 meters, but there's not much improvement, 2,500 meters. It drops to 1 bar again, finally, at 3,000 meters. The image transmission is lost in the same environment. It can fly 2,000 meters at a height of 40 meters. It can fly 2,000 meters at a height of 40 meters. This Hovind 20-meter one only flew 3,000 meters. It can't be this bad. Let's try using the one with the bottle control. Okay, now we're using the one with the bottle control. Still the same sticker, still the same 50-meter height, 1,000 meters, 2,000 meters. Did you see the flight altitude? It's dropped to 47 meters. This altitude hold is really annoying. 3,000 meters, hey, this is your level. At 3,800 meters, the signal weakens. Let's increase the altitude 4,000 meters. It prompts automatic return, never mind. Let's fly a bit more. At 4,500 meters, the battery has 60% remaining. We must return. There's nothing much to say about the return process. Let's talk directly about whether the new structure and the gimbal can be used as an aerial photography drone. First of all, its power is not that good. The speed is not fast enough. End gear is only 8 meters. S gear is only 12 meters compared to the Mini 4's 12 meters and 16 meters. It's still quite a bit worse, and the acceleration is also slow. Turning is also not that flexible. In short, the flight feel is sluggish. Other than this, I don't feel any difference from an aerial photography drone. Some simple aerial photography and camera movements or capturing the full view of the program, it can all do it, just needs to be sped up in post-production. Otherwise, it looks like it's not moving finally. Let's complain about the storage. It only gives 1.9G. What can you do with this? You can only shoot 2 minutes of 4K Steph's video or 71 DPGG photos. The practicality is basically zero. If you can't afford it, don't give it. Okay, let's summarize. This drone compared to the Neo has abandoned the freestyle mode, even abandoned the appearance, but in terms of performance. It has indeed given me a lot of surprises while ensuring ease of operation. The battery life has improved. The selfie mode is also better. The three-axis gimbal makes the picture more stable. The image quality has also gone from being able to capture to capturing well. And it can also shoot night scenes. It has added LiDAR, which can also ensure safety to a certain extent, although it still has some minor stutters and altitude instability issues, but its strengths outweigh its weaknesses at this price point. You'd be hard-pressed to find a drone with so many features and such good image quality. What's excessive is it can also handle most aerial photography with low requirements if you're just recording life or travel and can accept its looks. It might be better suited for you than those traditional drones for you.